Good afternoon. Welcome back. Okay, we have to apologize for the afternoon session. The screen will only be one side because our nutritionist bought in her own laptop and we could not post the other one on the other side at all. There is a fault, a virus, you know, on the thumb drive, right? And for whatever reason, we've been trying. So bear with us. For this next one, it's only just on one side and the other side will be the Slido. The Slido would be, you know, for you to post your question. So it's slido.com, HEX M728. That's where you post your question. You saw earlier, you know, the questions where it's been coming. It is through Slido. Okay. The next talk will be on functional fats. And, you know, every one of us know that we need fats to function. Okay. So we have actually got in Ms. Shweta Singh. She's presently working as a clinical nutritionist for Nutrition Matters in Singapore. And she's a member of the Singapore Nutrition and Dietetics Association and a member of the Indian Dietetic Association as well. Ms. Singh conducts health and nutritional talks in schools, community clubs and private associations. She also conducts corporate wellness programs across Singapore and diet counseling for weight management, PCOS, diabetes, heart disease, and other disorder. So let's not waste any more time and let's welcome, put our hands together and welcome Ms. Shweta Singh.
Very good afternoon, everybody. So today we are going to discuss about functional fats, and MCT is one of the functional fats that we are going to discuss today. And there have been a lot of studies currently going on, as well as in the last decades, many studies have been done on MCTs. And MCT is now probably the most, what you can say, prominent functional food that has been tested for various diseases. Okay, so let's take a look at MCTs. We'll start first with what are MCTs. Okay, so MCTs are medium chain triglycerides, which are naturally found in coconut oil and palm kernel oil. So see, fats are actually divided according to the chain of the molecule. Okay, so if it has more number of carbons, then it is the long chain. If it comes in the between 6 to 10 carbons, then it is the medium chain. Okay, so MCTs fall in the chain length between 6 to 10 carbons. Okay. Okay, so let's see a classification of the fats. So if you see here, which is the pointer? This one? Okay. So if you see in the classification of fats, MCTs actually fall into the saturated fat groups. Okay, so MCT is one of the type of a saturated fat, but because the chain length is smaller than the long ones, it is medium chain. Okay, and primarily in nature, you can find MCTs in coconut oil and palm kernel oil. Okay, the other long chain fatty acids which belong to the saturated group are your butter, dairy fat, lard, and tallow. Okay, we know about these fats, right? The monounsaturated and the polyunsaturated. So basically, the long chain fatty acids are all your oils, okay? The vegetable oils that we regularly use for cooking, okay? They are divided into the monounsaturated and the polyunsaturated. Your omega-3s, you know, the fish oil, flaxseed oil, they come under the polyunsaturated, okay? And of course, these are the healthy ones, the monounsaturated, which is the olive oil, canola oil, avocado oil. They all come under the MUFA. They're higher in MUFA, okay? So this is just a basic classification of the type of fat, okay? Just to show you that the medium chain belong under the saturated group, okay?
Sorry, we apologize, you know, for the fact that I think there was a little bit of a virus on the computer. That's the reason why we're having other issues as well.
Okay, great. So let's just look at what are the functions of fat. We all know that fat is an important part of a diet, right? So if you see here, fat helps in absorption of your vitamin A, D, E, and K. These are all your fat-soluble vitamins. Okay, so unless fat is present in your diet, you cannot absorb these vitamins. They are only soluble in the fats. So fat plays an essential role. Okay, now I've not mentioned here, but fat are also a source of essential fatty acids, which your body cannot produce. Right? So apart from the digestion and absorption of the fatty fat-soluble vitamins, they also provide essential fatty acids. And of course, we know that our brain is composed 60% of fat, okay? So for the brain and nerve health, fat and cholesterol are both very important, okay? That is why you'll find that, you know, now MCTs are being proposed for the brain health, cognitive health, okay? Because our brain is composed of fats, okay? Fat is very important for brain function. Fat also helps to insulate our bodies, okay? That is why you'll find that people who are very thin, they usually feel very cold because they don't have that insulation, right? Fat protects us from the cold, okay? And it helps to maintain our body temperature, okay? Apart from that, fat as ketones acts as an energy fuel for our body, okay? Now, how are MCTs different from the other fat? What is it about MCTs that make them different from the other fats? Okay, if you see here, this is a metabolism of MCT versus the long chain fats versus the oils, okay? If you see here, when you consume MCT oil, they are converted to ketones in the liver. They straight go to the liver, they are converted to ketone bodies, and they are burned for energy, okay? Whereas, when you consume the other oils, they are transported either to the muscles, to the liver, or the adipose tissue for storage. Okay, so this is the basic difference between the medium chain and the long chain fatty acids. The medium chain fatty acids, they are burned for energy, whereas the long chain fatty acids will be stored in your body as fat. Okay. If you see here, this is our gut, right? So as soon as we consume the MCTs from the intestine, they are straight transported via the portal vein to the liver. Okay, and in the liver, they are converted to ketone bodies, which provide energy. There is no other need for any other metabolism or any other pathway, okay? Once they are converted to ketones, they can straight be used up by your brain cells for energy, okay? Now, if you see the long chain fatty acids, okay? First of all, they are not soluble in water. Medium chain fats are soluble, okay? But long chain ones are not soluble. So they have to go through a long process of digestion and absorption, okay? For the metabolism, the long chain fatty acids are transported through the lymphatic system. The lymphatic system is the one where the long chain fatty acids get metabolized, okay? They need chylomicrons, they need cholesterol for transport, okay? And from there, through the peripheral circulation, they will go either to the liver, and then again they will be moved to either muscle or adipose tissue or heart or other tissues for storage. Okay, so once they are in the tissues, once they are in the muscles, they will only be used up if you need them for energy. Okay, because they act as source, right? They act as source of energy. They are stored in the body primarily for that reason, that whenever you need that energy source, the body will use all the fats that is stored for energy purpose, okay? So all the long chain fatty acids are primarily stored in the body to be used as fuel later, okay? So this is the primary difference between the medium chain and the long chain. The medium chain fatty acids will not be stored in the body. They will keep going, circulating into the circulation till the time either you use it as a fuel or they will be thrown out into the urine. Okay, so they are not stored in the body as fat. That's the primary difference. And that is why it makes a difference what kind of saturated fat you are having. Are they the medium chain ones or they are the long chain fats? Okay, that makes a huge impact. What are the benefits of this unique metabolism? They release energy as ketones and not as glucose. Okay, that is why you find that ketogenic diet that they are proposing for diabetes is because your body can use ketones for energy. It doesn't need glucose. Okay, that's the primary reason. Then if you see here, there is also a caloric difference. Okay, MCTs will give you 6.8 calorie per gram, whereas any other fat will give you 9 calorie per gram. Okay, they also boost your resting energy expenditure, your metabolism. Okay. See, we all are different, right? Our bodies are different, okay? There are many people who come to the dietitian and they say, oh, you know, my friend eats the same amount of food, you know, and she doesn't exercise, but she doesn't put on weight. So what is the difference? The difference is probably in the metabolism of the body, okay? Because maybe your friend has a higher metabolism. That friend can burn more calories even at rest. So even if both of you are sitting and watching TV, your friend is burning more calories at the same time than you are. Okay? Now, this difference in metabolism can be due to many reasons. It can be because an inactive thyroid. Okay? Your thyroid is not functioning very well. Maybe genetically, you have a lower metabolism. Okay? You were born with a lower metabolism. Okay? So there can be many differences in the metabolic rate. Okay, but what we have seen is that once you consume MCTs and they are turned into ketone bodies, these ketone bodies, they increase your metabolic rate. That means you will be burning more calories without doing anything. Okay, so it will increase your metabolism. Okay, that's what it means. As I said, the excess is circulated until burned as fuel. It is not stored in the body as fat. Okay, so till the time you are able to use them, they will be circulating in your body. Okay, otherwise, they are thrown out in the urine. Okay, that is why you find that ketones, people who follow the ketogenic diet, they test their urine for the ketones. Correct? But they are not stored in the body as fat. So MCTs, they nourish the brain, they recharge our energy levels, and they support a healthy metabolism. Whereas if you see the LCTs, because of the complex nature of the LCT, it is difficult to metabolize them. You know, there's a long process of metabolism that they have to go through. And they are always stored in the body for future use as an energy source. And there is a likelihood that they may increase your bad cholesterol. Okay, the long-chain fatty acids. Now, there have been many studies conducted on MCTs and if they can control our appetite and satiety. And what is being found is that there were two studies conducted on the appetite control and satiety level. There were two groups of overweight men, okay, and they were given either 20 gram of MCT or 20 gram of the long chain fats. Okay, what they found that after consuming 20 gram of MCT for breakfast, there was a lower food intake in the group at lunch because they had more satiety. They were feeling more full after having MCT for breakfast compared to the LCT group. Okay? They also did their blood test after 3 hours and they found that there was a lower rise in the triglycerides and the blood glucose after consumption of 20 gram of MCT. Okay? So, of course, there needs to be more research in this area. But what people find is that whenever they consume MCTs, the satiety is higher. And that leads to a lower consumption of calories for the next meal. Okay? See, it's also common, right? Whenever we have a high-fat meal, whether it is for breakfast, lunch, or dinner, we have a higher satiety level, right? We don't feel hungry immediately, you know? Compared to a carbohydrate meal, let's say you had a bread, compare it to maybe you had some fried chicken. You will feel more full after the fried chicken rather than the bread, right? It's because the digestion of fat takes time, okay? So similarly for MCTs, after having a meal with MCT oils, the satiety is higher. So your consumption of calories for the next meal goes down, okay? Eating MCTs can increase satiety and reduce food intake. There were many studies conducted for weight loss also to see whether MCTs are helpful in weight loss. Okay, Now, what they found is that after consuming MCTs, the oxidation of fatty acids increase. Why do you think oxidation is important? Because unless the fatty acids are oxidized, they will not be used for energy. Okay? Now, what they have found is that people who are overweight or obese, they have a lower fatty acid oxidation. Okay, so the body is not burning the fatty acids efficiently. So that's the difference between a normal weight individual and an obese individual. Okay, there's a difference in the fatty acid oxidation. So what they found is that once you consume MCTs, MCTs will of course be burned as fuel, but will also increase the oxidation of other fatty acids in the food or in your body. Okay, which is a good thing, right? Because we want the fats to be utilized for energy and not stored in the body, correct? So if we are able to oxidize more fat, it is good for us, right? Of course, it increases the metabolic rate, which causes the weight loss, okay? Higher weight loss is found in groups which consume MCT oil versus groups which consume LCT or a mixture of MCT and LCT, okay? So this was what they found in the studies. They also noticed that after consuming MCTs, there was a gradual decrease in the waist circumference without any other, without doing any other exercise or doing anything different. They found that between the two groups, people who consumed MCTs had a lower waist circumference, which is a good thing, right? Good news for us. We are always worried about the fat in the waist area, right? Very difficult to cut down, even after exercise. All the women after pregnancy, after childbirth, can vouch for this, right? Very difficult, okay? So what, and this was true for all the studies that they have done on MCTs, there was a gradual decrease in the waist circumference, okay? It means that it definitely helps you to utilize all the fat that you have stored in the body, right? It increases the fatty acid oxidation. So you are able to use the other stored fat also efficiently for energy. Now, what they say is that long-term substitution of MCT for LCT would produce weight loss if the energy intake remained constant. Now, this is very important, okay? So let's say if you want to try a ketogenic diet or you want to try MCTs in the diet, adding extra MCTs will not make a huge impact unless you cut down on the LCTs, okay? So you have to replace the long-chain ones with the medium chains. Okay, because see, after all, MCT is also a fat, right? If you keep on adding fat, it will not help you. Okay, so if you're looking for a ketogenic diet, if you're looking for any benefits from the MCT, you have to replace the fats. Okay, so I'll give you an example. So let's say if you're going to have maybe a toast with butter in the morning, so you can replace the butter with the MCT. You can have instead maybe a smoothie with the MCT oil or the MCT powder. Okay, so this is how you replace, you know, instead of the long chain fats, replace that with the MCTs. Okay, because if you keep on adding MCT without cutting down on the other fat, it will not provide that much benefit. You have to replace the other fats with the MCTs in the diet. Okay, and that is what all the studies are also pointing out. You know, the energy intake has to be the same. So if you're looking for some advantage from the MCTs, looking for weight loss, you have to replace the fats. Replace the other fats in the diet with MCT. And of course, we are going to learn some recipes, right? So you will know how to use MCT oils in your diet. Okay. Now, what they have also seen is that although coconut oil is 60% MCTs, but compared to a pure MCT oil, it is not as effective. Okay. So if you are specifically looking for weight loss and satiety, higher satiety from a meal, you have to use a MCT oil, okay, which is 100% MCT. Because coconut oil, although it is 60% MCT, it still has the other fats, right? So what they found out in the study was that MCT oil had a higher satiety and feeling of fullness after breakfast than the coconut oil, okay? And of course, the group with the MCT oil had reduced food intake for the next meal. okay? And see, MCT oil, pure MCT oil is also tasteless, okay? It doesn't have a very strong taste. So adding MCT oil to any of your meals, any of the soups, breakfast, you know, it's very easy rather than the coconut oil, okay? So ease of use and on the taste also, they are much easier, okay? Because many people, they don't like the coconut taste, you know, it has a very strong taste. So some people are not used to that. MCT oil, on the other hand, is almost tasteless, and it can be easily added to any of the meals. Okay, so ease of consumption is higher for MCTs than coconut oil. They did a study on muscle strength and function in frail elderly, hospitalized elderly, okay, or elderly who have very poor muscle function. And what they found is that MCTs together with amino acid and vitamin 3 can improve muscle strength and function. How they test muscle strength is that they make them do some exercises and then they test their grip. You know, how good is the grip? So then they know how well is the muscle performing, okay? So this is how they tested it. And they found that the frail elderly who were probably hospitalized, in the study they were hospitalized, they had a better body weight after the supplementation. They had an increase in the right hand grip strength, you know? The grip improved. So that means the muscles were working well, right? They also increased in the walking speed. There was an increase in the walking speed. They could walk faster. So these movements, they show that the muscles were working better, right? But this is only true if you consume this in a combination, okay? Not MCTs alone. And of course, there are many research still going on. More studies have to come before we can, you know, say that they actually work, okay? But so far, whatever research has been done, the supplementation of all the three MCTs with the amino acid and vitamin 3 works together for the muscle strength, okay? And another study was done again with the same supplements, and they found that there was an improvement in the cognitive function, okay? But as I said, we still need more studies to confirm that. Okay, more evidence is required. Now let's come for MCTs for Alzheimer's. Okay, Alzheimer's, as we know, is a very common disease among the elderly. Alzheimer's is characterized by dementia. And of course, as it progresses, it can lead to behavioral changes, changes in ability to think, eat, or just do your regular task, right? Everything is affected, okay? So there have been many studies on Alzheimer's and MCTs, and MCTs seems to be very beneficial for Alzheimer's and cognitive impairment, okay? You can see here clearly, right? This is a healthy brain, and this is the brain with a severe Alzheimer's disease. You see the mass, how it has shrunk, the brain size, it's almost gone down, right? So this shows that there is a severe impairment of the brain mass in a Alzheimer's disease, which is progressed to a very later stages. Okay. Now, Dr. Mary Newport, she has been a pioneer in the research of MCTs for Alzheimer's disease. Okay. In brief about her, Dr. Mary Newport is a medical doctor. She is a neonatologist. She specializes in care for the newborns. Okay. And this is her husband. So when he was around 50 years of age, he was discovered with Alzheimer's. He started having symptoms of Alzheimer's, okay? Now, Dr. Mary Newport, although she was a doctor, she couldn't do much to help her husband, okay? But that did not stop her because, see, Alzheimer doesn't have a specific cure. There are no specific medications which can stop Alzheimer's, okay? Although some medications say that they can slow down the progress of the disease, but still there are no medications to stop it, okay? Or stop the disease from progressing, or you can say to reverse it, okay? There's no cure. So Dr. Mary Newport, she tried to find a cure on herself, you know? So what she did was that she found out that there was a special medicine which can be used for Alzheimer's, and she came to know that it was just pure MCT oil, okay? So She pioneered the research on MCTs for Alzheimer's, and she saw great improvements in her husband's health. Okay, and she chronicles all her experience and discoveries in this book, Alzheimer's Disease. Okay, she has also written 3 other books, and she is an international speaker on the subject. Okay, I have a small video for Dr. Mary Newport's discoveries. Let's take a look at that.
In 2004, a neonatologist named Mary Newport received heartbreaking news that her husband had been diagnosed with Alzheimer's. As his disease progressed, she couldn't help but dedicate herself to studying the latest research and reviewing the latest clinical trials on Alzheimer's. She came across a patent application for a medical food referred to as AC1202, which she discovered was just a fancy name for medium-chain triglyceride oil. Mary's husband was scheduled for a screening for a new Alzheimer's clinical trial the next morning and was not accepted due to scoring a 14 out of 30 on a memory test, which indicated his Alzheimer's had progressed too far to be a test subject. Part of his assessment was drawing a clock, which showed that he was now on the verge of severe Alzheimer's. After these disappointing results, Mary decided to give MCT oil a shot and knew that coconut oil contained around 60% medium-chain triglycerides. The next day, her husband had another screening, so she administered 7 teaspoons of coconut oil to him that morning. Surprisingly, he scored 4 points higher and 18 on the same test as the day before. After these promising but not conclusive results, they decided to keep the doses of coconut oil going, and as they did, his symptoms diminished rather than progressed. After only 14 days, he was asked to draw a clock again, and his clock went from being a few random shapes and numbers to a drawing that anyone could identify as a clock. During the first months of adding coconut oil to his diet, they witnessed his personality and sense of humor return, tremors and visual disturbances were resolved, and he was able to resume normal activities they thought he would never do again. I know this story makes MCT oil seem like some sort of miracle drug, but really, the astonishing regenerative effects on the brain are due to the production of ketones through the breakdown of MCTs. Through supplementation of coconut oil or MCT oil, or a low-carb, ketogenic diet, we can produce ketone bodies which have incredible health benefits. To describe how ketones have this incredible impact on the brain for Alzheimer's patients, we first have to understand the way Alzheimer's affects the brain negatively. With a standard Western diet, glucose is the primary fuel source for the brain. The brain and other organs in the body use glucose from nutritional intake of carbohydrates to produce ATP, or adenosine triphosphate, which is the energy source for all processes in the body. In Alzheimer's patients, mitochondrial function is abnormal. You can think of mitochondria as working like gasoline generators, but instead of using gas to generate electricity, the mitochondria use glucose to produce ATP. In cases of Alzheimer's, it's been observed that due to insulin resistance, glucose has trouble penetrating the cell wall and entering the mitochondria. PET scans have shown vast differences in a normal brain versus a brain with Alzheimer's. The uptake of glucose is severely decreased, resulting in a lack of available energy for the brain. This is a problem that's also seen in other areas of the body with individuals diagnosed with diabetes, which is why Alzheimer's is now being referred to as type 3 diabetes, or diabetes of the brain. The amazing thing about ketones as an alternative fuel source is that they do not need insulin to allow them to enter cells and mitochondria. They're therefore able to bypass insulin deficiency and insulin resistance in the brain. In the past decade, there's been a ton of tests done on the effects of ketones on the brain of Alzheimer's patients, and the results are becoming irrefutable. In a survey of 184 individuals with dementia who were given a regimen of medium-chain triglycerides, an incredible 167 of the 184 showed quantitative and qualitative improvements. That makes MCTs 91% effective on a variety of different forms of dementia. More specifically, 59% had improved memory and cognition, 42% saw improvements in social behavior and mood, 35% regained speech and verbal skills, and 24% were able to return to regular daily activities. Through this same method of ketones providing new energy pathways, a ton of other diseases can be effectively treated. Diseases like Parkinson's, multiple sclerosis, ALS, type 1 and 2 diabetes, and ketones have even shown improvements in some forms of autism.
Okay, so we just saw that what happens in an aging brain. Basically, what happens is that as we age, our brains are not able to use glucose very effectively for energy. Because we know that, see, glucose is the main fuel source, right? Glucose is the one which gives us energy. And brain also relies on glucose for energy. But what happens is that as we age, our ability to use glucose for energy goes down. Now, there are different metabolic pathways which affect this, you know? Why your neurons are not able to use glucose for energy, okay? There are many different pathways. Because, see, it is not as simple as 1 plus 1 is 2, okay? So let's say if this is my cell and I am glucose and I want to enter, it's not as simple that I can just enter like that, okay? There are many other transporters, so I need somebody to carry me from here to there, right? So there are transporters, there is insulin. You know, insulin is the key which will take the glucose inside the cell. Now, what happens in an aging brain is that either the transporters are affected, there are not too many transporters which will take the glucose to the cell. Okay? They also find that in an aging brain, the insulin is lower. There is not enough insulin in the brain to carry the glucose into the cell. Okay? Plus, as we age, our neurons are not that efficient, you know. There is a decline in the, the quality of the neurons, okay? So there are different ways why our brain is not able to use glucose for energy, okay? Now at this time, when your brain is not able to use glucose for energy, okay, there is resistance for glucose, right? We saw that there is a resistance in the cells, okay? So then what happens is that there is brain fog. Okay, you are not able to think clearly. Of course, your brain doesn't have energy. There's no energy coming in, right? How are you able to think clearly? You cannot. Okay, so there is brain fog, there is confusion, there is memory loss. You know the simple things like you forget where you have kept your keys. Okay, you forget, you had your phone now, but after some time you forget where you kept your phone. Okay, so simple things like that. And this happens not only to the aged population. This starts happening probably when we are in our 30s or 40s, you know. And we think that probably because we have too much on our mind, that is why it's happening, you know. So maybe that is one reason. Maybe we are doing multitasking. Maybe we have too many things on our mind. But probably we are also developing insulin resistance, you know. And our brain is not able to use glucose efficiently, okay. So at such times, ketones are very effective source of energy for your brain, okay? Because ketones, they don't need that complex pathway that a glucose cell would need, a glucose molecule would need. And ketones can directly enter the cells of the brain and provide energy. Your brain can use ketone bodies as fuel, okay? And they have found this in many patients, especially diabetics. People, diabetic patients who have been put on ketones, they suddenly have this, you know, a thing like as if the light, somebody switched on the light bulb, you know, because suddenly they have this mental clarity. They're able to think clearly, they're able to remember things, okay? So that itself is an indication that the brain was deprived of energy, and once you supply them with the ketone bodies, your brain can use up the ketones for energy, okay? Okay, so ketones are very effective for cognitive function and memory. Ketones can slow the aging process. You know, they can you can have new neurons, you know, developing, and the brain is able to utilize the ketones very effectively for energy. It can slow the aging process. It can reduce the neurodegeneration, which is primary factor for the dementia and Alzheimer disease. Okay. It can decrease inflammation and neuronal damage. It can improve the brain cell growth and function. Okay? As I said, there are many complex pathways which are happening inside the brain and why you are not able to use glucose effectively. But ketone bodies seem to have a good effect on all that. Okay? So ketone bodies can help you to develop new brain cells. You can effectively use the ketones for energy. Okay, and basically they prevent the neurodegeneration from happening. You saw that Alzheimer brain, right? How it looks? It actually shrinks in size because you don't have enough brain mass. You're gradually decreasing on the brain mass, right? But as you start taking ketones and your brain is able to utilize the ketones for energy, I don't know if you remember the PET scan that they showed. You know how your brain uses up glucose? The PET scan will show an improvement in the uptake of energy after taking ketones, okay? Now, what they have found is that caprylic acid is a type of ketone, okay? Just by one supplementation of the caprylic acid, it can improve the cognitive function for individuals. But this is true for only those who are negative for this particular gene type. The APOE4 allele is a particular gene type which is present in most of the Alzheimer patients, okay? And it increases your risk for Alzheimer's and dementia. So only for those people who are negative for this particular gene type, caprylic acid is very effective in improving the cognitive function. Just by one single dose of this particular fatty acid, you can improve your cognitive function. You know, so what they do is that after giving the subjects caprylic acid, then they do their memory test, you know, after after 3 hours of supplementation. So they perform a memory test on these subjects, and they realize that just by supplementation of a single dose, it improves the cognitive function, okay? So medium-chain fatty acids can be easily incorporated into the diet if you are already having symptoms of, you know, memory loss, there is brain fog, confusion state, where you're not able to think clearly, okay? So these are earlier signs of dementia or Alzheimer's, you know, especially if you're diabetic. It can be an early sign of Alzheimer's disease. So maybe you can talk to your doctor and ask them if you can start on the supplementation. Because what they have found is that if you start the supplementation early, then it is very effective. Because it can stop the damage from happening, right? It can stop the progression, okay? If you start at a later stage, it may not be as effective, okay? So starting at a preclinical stage, when you are just starting to have those memory loss, okay? Starting at that preclinical stage is really effective, okay? So if I would suggest that if you're already having some symptoms, maybe you can talk to your doctor and you can start supplementation. Now there was another study conducted in overweight men, and they wanted to check if MCTs are effective for insulin sensitivity in diabetes. Now what they did is that they divided the group of subjects. One group was taking 18 gram MCT, the other group was taking 18 gram of corn oil. Okay, and they found that there was a 17% improvement in the insulin sensitivity after 90 days. Okay, insulin sensitivity means that you don't need too much of insulin to bring your glucose levels down. Okay, that means you are sensitive enough to the insulin. Okay, your body doesn't require too much of insulin to perform. Okay, so they found that the group which was consuming MCT oil, there was a drastic improvement in the insulin sensitivity as compared to the corn oil group. There was in fact a worsening of sensitivity among the corn oil group, okay? And this was just for the insulin sensitivity. There was other benefits of consuming MCT oil. All the subjects who were taking MCT oil, they had a reduced body weight. Again, reduced body weight, lower serum cholesterol, and there was this body weight probably is said correlated with the improvements in the insulin sensitivity, right? The doctors always say that if you want to improve your insulin sensitivity, you have to lose weight, because all that extra fat around your cells acts as a resistance for the glucose to enter the cells, right? So a lower body weight can always improve your insulin sensitivity, but MCT oil can definitely help to decrease this body weight, okay? So maybe because the body weight went down, so the insulin sensitivity improved, okay? We definitely need more research because MCT oil is still new, okay? It is still new as a functional food. We definitely need more evidence and more research before we can, you know, advise people to start taking MCTs for insulin sensitivity. Okay, but so far, whatever the research has been done, it shows a good improvement in the insulin sensitivity. Also because the subjects always lose weight whenever they are taking MCT oils. Okay, so it can be either ways, but there is definitely an improvement. Okay. Now, this is a diagram which shows how insulin helps in the glucose metabolism, why insulin is important. And this is an insulin resistant state. As I said, you know, insulin is a key which will allow the glucose to enter the cell, okay? There are many other transporters also. It's not as simple as one plus one. You know, if I want to go there, I can just go there. No, I will need a transporter. I will need insulin to open the cell for me so that I can enter, okay, as a glucose molecule, okay? Now, in an insulin resistant state, what happens is that this lock and key mechanism is affected, okay? What happens is that the cell, you know, you can see the receptors here, they are affected. So insulin is not able to attach to the cell, okay? Because see, insulin is the key, right? It will help to open the cell for the glucose to enter. If you see here in an insulin resistant cell, the insulin is not able to attach to the cell and therefore the glucose is not able to enter, okay? So this is a typical scenario of an insulin resistant state. The excess glucose will always stay in your blood because the insulin is not able to act on the glucose, right? And this is because here the cell receptor is affected. That's why it's happening, okay? So when we say that you should not have too much of sugar, the primary reason is that because high level of sugar will need higher insulin, right? To bring the sugar down in the blood. Now what happens is that if you constantly keep eating a lot of sugar and a lot of carbohydrates, simple carbohydrates especially, okay? Your body keeps on producing more and more insulin to bring the sugar down, okay? And that leads to an insulin resistant state, okay? Where your body is tired of the excess insulin. The cells are tired of the excess insulin. They say, enough, we don't want any more insulin, okay? So that gives rise to insulin resistance, okay? Another study conducted on a group of MCT and LCT, what they did is that they divided the group into pure MCT, then a combination of MCT and LCT, and pure LCT, okay? So three groups. Of course, what they found was that after 1.5 months, the group which were taking MCT or a combination of MCT and LCT had lower insulin resistance as compared to the group which was taking only an LCT, okay? So what they are saying is that with a total energy and fat consumption controlled, as I said, you know, you cannot go excess on the fat. MCT is also a fat. So if you want to take MCT, you have to replace MCT for the LCT in your diet, okay? But what they say is that if you replace 50% of your dietary fat with MCT, there will be an improvement in the insulin resistance just by a 50% replacement, okay? Now, how you can use MCT oil and powder in your diet? You can add them to your smoothies, drinks. You can use them for salad dressings, okay? You will find a lot of recipes on YouTube where people are using MCT oil for mayonnaise and other salad dressings, okay? Because ketogenic diet is the new thing now, right? So everywhere you will find information on keto diet. You can go to YouTube and find more recipes on how you can use MCTs for salad dressings. Of course, you can also add MCT powder and MCT oil to the soups. It makes them more creamier. I've tried it, okay? So it's very easy to add MCT on any of the meals, you know? And it's almost tasteless. You don't realize the taste. It doesn't have a very strong taste. So you can easily add them to your smoothies, to your salad dressings, to your soups. Okay, some risk and consideration because MCT, as I said, is also a type of fat. Okay, before you start on any supplementation, first thing is to consult your doctor, okay, especially if you have any underlying disease, like if you already suffer from heart disease or diabetes, okay, you have to consult your doctor. Start with 1 or 2 teaspoons initially, and then gradually increase your dose. Because some of the common side effects of MCTs are GI disorders. People have abdominal pain, some people suffer from and gastric disturbances, okay, very common. So if you want to avoid them, you can either have MCTs with food, okay, or you start with a lower dose first. As I said, MCT oil and supplements are also fat. You have to replace the other fats for MCTs. Okay? Don't add extra MCTs to the diet. First, start by replacing. Okay? And then if your doctor, of course, allows you, you can add more MCTs to your diet later. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Shweta. Let's take some questions. Okay, question number one. You said that MCT is a saturated fat group, but I hear that saturated fats are bad. Is MCT good or bad?
Correct. So MCT is a type of saturated fat, yes. But not all saturated fats behave the same way. As we said, you know, because of the chain length, they act differently in the body. And we saw that MCTs have a different metabolism. They don't go through the same metabolism of the long chain fatty acids. And so far, whatever the studies have been done on MCTs, after consumption of MCTs, they have found lower triglycerides and lower serum cholesterol. Okay? So far, whatever studies have been done, they don't show any higher cholesterol or triglycerides. So as far as we can say, they are quite safe. Okay? But always consult your doctor before you are adding extra dose of MCTs. Okay? You have to consult your doctor first.
Okay, question number two. Are there other sources of ketones?
As we said that ketones, basically your body will produce ketones if you are in a fasting state or starvation. Okay? That is your body's natural mechanism to have energy. Okay? If you are fasting for a long time or you are starving, that's how probably the human species evolved. You know, when earlier people did not have enough sufficient food, the body was burning down and burning down the fat and using the ketone bodies for energy. Okay, so other way of getting ketones apart from the diet or MCT oil is fasting. That is why intermittent fasting is also very famous now. You know, people are trying intermittent fasting because it helps to burn your stored fats. Okay, and the body can use the ketones which are produced from the fat for energy.
Okay, the next question, is MCT oil extracted from some natural oil?
Yes, it is extracted from either palm kernel oil or coconut oil.
Okay, does coconut oil constitute change if used for frying food at high temperature?
I think coconut oil is very stable because it is high in saturated fat, so it can be used for very high temperature cooking or baking, even frying. It's quite stable.
But the only thing is that after the taste is quite challenging,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so that is why MCT, if you're looking for a ketogenic diet, probably MCT will be helpful.
Yeah.
Adding ketones.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that was also one of the main reasons I don't take good to coconut oil. Okay. I saw an infant formula adding MCT. Can I assume it is safe for children also?
They add MCTs to infant formula because it is easy to absorb. Okay, but children will, they may not need any supplement in with regards to MCT oil, you know. If you can just give them normal coconut oil or natural oil or even your dairy fats like butter and all, which have some amount of MCTs, they have about 5 to 10% MCTs. So for children, a natural source will be better than adding, a supplement like an MCT oil to the diet. But okay. It's quite safe.
Okay, I understand that MCT comprises caprylic acid. Wow, a lot of acid, huh? Okay. What is this percentage of C6 and C8 in Dr. MCT oil?
Dr. MCT, I think the C8 is higher. I don't know exactly, but I think 60% is C8 and 40% is C6.
Maybe so this question, we can leave it to the people from Dr. MCT to answer during the cookery session. Is it all right?
Yeah, know for sure that caprylic is higher in Dr. MCT.
Is there any other questions? Yeah.
Coconut flesh or coconut milk be an alternative to taking coconut oil?
See, it depends what is it that you want to take it for. You know, if you want to lose weight or you're looking at specific advantage from a MCT source, you know, then coconut may not be sufficient enough. Okay, because for a therapeutic effect, you need a higher dose of MCTs. Okay, and coconut is only 60% MCTs. So if you're looking for, let's say, improvement in your brain function or memory or if you're looking for improvement in insulin resistance, you need at least 4 teaspoons of pure MCT. 4 teaspoons of pure ketones. Okay? So to get that much from the coconut, you really need to have a lot of coconut. So unless you're ready to eat that much of coconut, but coconut is also saturated fat. So before you start on anything new, please consult your doctor. Is it safe for you? Yeah.
Okay, well, Anna is, setting up her cooking demonstration. Is there any other questions?
What we say is that for frying, try to use oils which are higher in monounsaturated fats and saturated fats. Don't use too many PUFAs, like the corn or sunflower, safflower, okay? Because they can be easily oxidized to trans fats. Because they are polyunsaturated, right? They are quite unsaturated. So saturation means they can easily get hydrogen from the atmosphere and they can turn to trans fats. Okay, so for frying, I would suggest you can have rice bran oil, which has a good amount of saturates and MUFA. Okay, coconut oil is also very good. Okay, but it is slightly more higher in saturated fat compared to rice bran. So go for MUFAs and saturate, which are more stable at higher temperature. Is there any other questions? Rice bran oil. Yes.
If there's any other questions, if no other questions, then let's give Ms. Shweta a round of applause.
Thank you so much.
Okay.